And the perpetrator is now the victim. Mm-hmm. And that just drives me crazy.
Thank you.
Ah, there we go. Good. I'm a little dark back there, but I'm fine. Good afternoon. We had a few technical difficulties, like the machine caught me off guard. Today we have a brother, Elijah Shabazz, brother Elijah Shabazz. He's a researcher. And he's going to boost our knowledge of the origins of the Redbone people.
That is correct.
Anyway, he'll explain it. We had a roll-in from Atlanta Black Star about five countries that imported Europeans to lighten up their population. And now we're going to segue into that young brother who is a magnificent researcher, and we're gonna get back to Africa in between Martin Luther and Donald Trump. We're gonna take it on. It's a pleasure to have you
here,
brother.
It's a pleasure to be here, Brother Nat Wood. Thank you so much for having me. And
you can just talk to me. Don't that's your camera, but
okay.
It'll be
all right. This is really a part two. Mm-hmm. I originally started the subject with Brother Leroy,
Brother Leroy is Brother Leroy Baylor.
Yes.
Who is a tremendous brother. He's been doing this forever.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so we were discussing
books that matter and
people that matter. Yes. And so we were discussing the Fulani origins of the Redbone people.
Mm-hmm.
And his
by
show.
Redbone, you mean?
Redbone is a term generally used among African Americans. So you know about the Redbone.
I know what that
means. Right.
But,
so basically, the Redbone people are people that look something like yourself, myself,
of
a reddish hue.
Right.
And there was
down south is they say Redbone more. Up north they say High Yellow more.
High Yellow. Right. Exactly.
But yes, it's a lighter skin.
Right. Now it later became a term of basically skin complexion.
Correct.
But these people that particularly existed in places like South Carolina, Virginia, on the Gullah Islands of South Carolina, New Orleans.
Right.
These were people that had very similar features to each other, very similar characteristics,
right.
And they had certain practices. And from where my family's from in South Carolina is a place called Privateer, Sumter, South Carolina. It's a county. Sumter is a county in South Carolina, and Privateer is a county in Sumter. And there was a research done by one Mr. Furman, because he saw these people that were described as Redbone people, and one of the politicians there was a Redbone. And there was great speculation as to where these people came from and how they came about.
Mm-hmm.
And so he did a genealogy, a research on these people. Now, back then, DNA technology was not available for him to confirm his research. And he said that, okay, these people more than likely are from Jewish people. They must be mixed with European. They must be mixed with Indian. Mm-hmm. And these people, they were never never enslaved. And the Redbone people basically took the Indian identity from my research and from my hypothesis, I would say, they took the Indian identity because if you had a choice between holding on to your African identity and being enslaved, or saying that you're an Indian, you'll take the choice of being, you call the Indian, and identify as an Indian.
Right.
So in a lot of our families, particularly in South Carolina, and I know in my family, we just knew 1,000% that we're from this particular Indian tribe and so forth and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And But we never considered that there is an African tribe that looks exactly like us.
Mm.
Now, you just did something from Atlanta Black Star
of whites
being imported to lighten the population.
To lighten up population.
And particularly in Southern Africa, you have a very, very dark-skinned population of people, but you also have the hunter-gatherers, the sand people,
mm-hmm.
as they call them, who are already a lighter-skinned people.
Mm-hmm.
What these Europeans didn't know in South Carolina and in other areas was that Africa is very diverse.
Right.
The more you go up north, you have lighter skinned people.
Right.
In North Africa. And you have, and the more you go south, you have a more burnt skinned people.
Mm.
But most of our people, particularly here in North America, we thought, well, if you had this type of complexion, you can't possibly be from Africa. You had to have been mixed with some other people to get this complexion. So my research was that the Fulani people, the same reaction.
In other words, you couldn't have come from Africa,
right?
And not have been, well, the time period we're talking about, raped into this color.
Well, that is the general understanding.
Right.
That is the general understanding. That is the accepted understanding.
Correct.
You see?
Correct.
And
correct.
So when they saw these red bone people, this is correct. The conclusion they came to. Oh, correct. You must be mixed.
Correct.
However, the Fulani people, when Europeans began to discover Africa back in the 17th century, the 16th century, explorers like Hanno and others who went through Africa, they had the same reaction that Furman, the researcher in South Carolina, had. Who are these people? Where do they come from? They don't have the same skin complexion as other Africans. They classified them as red people. They classified them as Lucio Ethiopians, which mm-hmm. means white Ethiopians.
Right.
Because these people, they were there. They had not mixed with white people, but they already had this reddish copper tone
right.
complexion.
So, excuse me for cutting you off,
mm-hmm.
but what I think you're saying is that there is a gradation of skin tones in indigenous Africa itself.
Yes, exactly.
That you want to talk about.
Yes, and that these
and these were Fulani.
These are called Fulani people. They are also called Berber people.
Berber people.
Berber people of North Africa. But
what
particularly,
country are we talking?
You're talking about countries. We're talking about Morocco. We're talking about Mauritania,
mm-hmm.
and those countries there.
All right. All right.
However, the Fulani were in West Africa,
all right.
and particularly places like South Carolina.
Right.
South Carolina. Their main product was rice.
That is correct.
And they became so rich from the rice right. that they were the ones who
they taught the Europeans how to grow rice, because the Europeans was basically lost.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So
they couldn't feed themselves.
Exactly.
Even with all this free labor, they didn't know what to do with
they
it
didn't
because
know.
They had no
exactly.
product.
Exactly. So there are certain tribes
right.
who are rice growers.
Correct.
And they come from the Gulf of Guinea, which was later called the Rice Coast. So there was a target for these particular Guineans to come to areas like South Carolina, West Virginia, and Louisiana because there are swamplands there.
Right.
And in order to grow rice,
right.
you need swamplands.
Right.
Now, rice is, in order to grow rice, it takes a certain type of technology and engineering. It's kind of complicated. You can't just throw some seeds on the ground and some rice grows.
Mm-hmm.
You have to know the different maturation periods. You have to know when to plant. You have to know actually astronomy in order to grow this crop. So they went after people with this particular knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And these people were in Senegambia. And among the Senegambians, you have the Fulani, you have the Susu, you have the Madinka, you have the wall off people. And these peoples were brought over to areas where there were swamplands, Georgia, South Carolina, Louisiana, Virginia, particular areas like that. And it is in these areas that you find these red bone people. Mm-hmm. So from my research, I came to the conclusion that these red bone people were not from Indians and mixed with white and so forth, that they basically came with the very same complexion mm-hmm. that they already had when they were in Africa. Mm-hmm. See, one thing is that, yes, Europeans can, rape black women and, and plant their seed in white women. Yes, and that is correct. However, you cannot impregnate a black man. You know, so the seed of the black man is going. Yes. So the seed of the black man is going to remain the same. You know, you can't change that. So again, just going back to just doing the research, it was after I did that research, because I had a particular experience where there's an influx of West Africans in New York City at this time. Mm. And being a Muslim, it was during the month of Ramadan when I went to pray, and I ran into a Fulani brother, perchance. I was going to make my prayer, and he saw me. I had skipped him on the wudu line, and he became upset. So he looks at me, and he speaks to me in the Pula language. Mm-hmm. He didn't see African-American.
Yeah.
He saw one of his cousins because they know each other by their faces.
Yeah.
It's not just a skin tone. There are certain features that are unique to these particular people that I have.
I've had that experience.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. And when you have experiences like that, especially with West Africans, there's no reason to doubt. If they tell you, you are from these people, there's no reason for you to doubt that you are from those people.
Right.
Because if you can look at a pit bull and know it's a pit bull, if you look at a rhinoceros and know it's a rhinoceros by his face, you don't say, let me do a DNA to make sure that this pit bull is truly a pit bull or this German shepherd is truly a German shepherd. Mm-hmm. When you look at that face, you know what creature it is. And it's the same with our people from West Africa. When they look at you, if they say, you look exactly like these people over here, don't doubt it one bit. And I'm going to tell you what happened with me. So I accepted it 100%. And when I did the research on the Fulani people, and they look exactly like my family. I even saw one Fulani brother that made me scream because I thought I was looking at myself. That's how much we resembled each other. So I told this to my grand uncle, whose name is Alfred Holiday, who was actually born in Privateer, Sumter, South Carolina. Okay? And I said, we are no doubt from this people. We should go to Africa and see for ourselves. And we did. We went to Guinea. Now, Guinea is the place where they as I said earlier, they brought people from South Carolina to South Carolina, Louisiana, and all these places. In fact, they say in Louisiana, New Orleans, that 95% of the black people in New Orleans come from Guinea. Now, the evidence is several places. The evidence is not is also in the what this was called Creole. Now, I heard Beyonce song. And she called herself a Creolean, a black mixed with Creole. And it's funny because our people think Creole is a DNA. Creole is not a DNA. Creole is a language. Creole is when you take several languages and you put them together. That's what makes a Creole. It's not a DNA. Okay. So in the Creole of Louisiana, you find the Mandinka words, you find the Susu words, you find the Fulani words. In the Gullah language, in South Carolina, on the Gullah Islands, you also find these various African languages. But when they count, they say Go, Didi, Tati, Nai, Joey, Jago, J, Didi, J, Tati. These are Fulani numbers. So the evidence is there in the language that Fulani people were indeed brought to South Carolina, Louisiana, and other places. So when we went to Guinea, the reaction was the same. the same reaction that I got from the brother that I met during the month of Ramadan is the same reaction I got all throughout Guinea. Mm-hmm. When they told them I was from America, they said, no. This guy is Pulo Futa. He's Pulo Futa. Mm. He's Fulani from Futa Jalan, which is the pure Fulani up there in the mountains of Futa Jalan. They said, no, this guy, he's not American. He's Pulo Futa.
Right.
Now, mind you, we had not did any DNA tests. Mm-hmm. We just went. And when I got up to a place called Mamu, I had a very deep experience. When I got to Mamu, I was praying, and it was me and our driver, and we got out to a masjid to pray. And while he was calling the Adhan to pray, the Fulani elders came out. And when he saw the elders, as it is customary in Fulani tradition, you yield to the elders. That's African tradition in general.
Right.
So two of these elders, they had a face very similar to my father. And I one of them stood next to me. And as we were praying, I had this experience. It was a very deep experience. When he stood next to me, my elbow touched his elbow. And it was like an electric jolt that went through my body. And I felt the spirit of my ancestors right there. Mm. And I began to cry, like, uncontrollably.
Right.
And we went down, we made one rak'ah because we were praying Maghrib, and I came up again, and I felt that jolt again. And I kept crying. Tears were coming down my eyes. And and then we went down for the third rak'ah, and I came back up, and I felt the jolt each time. So, you know, when we finished praying, you salam out to the right, to the left. And usually you sit and you do like a thicker, but I got straight up because I was embarrassed.
Right.
Because I was crying. Mm. And I could not stop crying. So I'm crying and I'm trying to stop because I'm embarrassed. I don't like to see people, you know, let people see me cry. Mm-hmm. And I was trying to get rid of it, but it wouldn't leave me. And it wasn't until that we got into the car. And my driver, Mustafa, who was a Fulani man, and our interpreter was a Fulani woman, and he saw me crying, and he knew what it was. He knew what that was. He knew that I had felt the spirit of my ass. He already knew. And he alerted the people by phone at the town where we were going to as to what happened, and they knew. And by the time we reached there, the whole town knew. So We went and we kept going all through Futa Jalan. And again, we saw the same thing over and over. We saw the features of our family.
Right.
Now, we come back to just recently. I was supposed to do an interview with Brother Leroy last week.
Mm-hmm.
But as God would have it, lines got crossed. It didn't happen.
Right.
So now I'm here this week.
Right.
And just this past week, I finally looked at the DNA.
Right.
Of my family from South Carolina.
Excellent.
So here it is. It was meant for me to do this interview this week and not last week.
Right.
You know. So through this whole journey, it's been a spiritual experience that coincided to let me know that I was being guided into this. So we did the DNA, and we looked at the map because the type of DNA test it gives you the map of where you're from. And the first thing I noticed was Guinea. So the place where we went, the place where my research led me, the DNA confirmed that yes, absolutely, my family from Privateer, Sumter, South Carolina, is from Guinea. And we did the test on the elder, he's in his 80s now, and he's the last living relative of our people from Privateer, Sumter, South Carolina.
Yeah.
And it confirmed that, yes, we're from Futa Jalan. Not only was our DNA strong, because the DNA reading, they give you like a strong color in the epic center of where your DNA is, and then it gets lighter as it goes out and lighter as it goes out, you know. So you know where your DNA relation is most present.
Mm-hmm.
Every single Fulani kingdom. Futa Jalan, ancient Takrur, which is in southern Mauritania, the Massina, which is in Mali, the Fubiyoro, Jine, which is the great Fulani town that you read about when you read about ancient Timbuktu and Jine. These are sister cities. The DNA is all in that area, strong. And what was interesting, all this time, we thought we were mixed with Indians, 0% Native American, 0%. But we thought because our hair was a little different and our skin features a little different, that we must be 0%.
Well, not to cut you off, and don't lose your place. But all throughout the world, especially in Europe, but not exclusively in Europe, probably most prevalent right here in the United States, but even in Arab Muslim countries, the issue of Africanism is a point of political consternation, be it the acceptance of or the denial of the African in you is a source of consternation for a lot of people.
That is correct.
You get resistance one way or the other.
Yes.
You know,
you get
the world telling you you're not.
Yes.
Many of us don't want to accept the Africanism in us.
Yes, exactly.
And there's different degrees. In some instances, the word black, people will do anything rather than be called black.
That is
people
correct.
Do anything rather than be called Africa.
Yes.
So the very subject of first of all, the acceptance of Africa in you is a political statement.
Yes.
And then researching African roots is a political statement. And it's not just a source of consternation, like I said, in America and Europe, but all throughout the world, in the Caribbean, in Latin America, in Arab countries, how black you are. What made you first decide this, and how did you approach it in the beginning? Because a lot of people would like to find out where they come from. But then a lot of people are kind of scared because
when you take that journey, you don't know where it's going to lead. Right. So how I came about this, actually, it wasn't really a search that I made. It came to me. Mm. You know, I say it like this. I didn't find the Fulani. The Fulani found me.
Wow.
You know, because, again, it happened. And this is how I know. This is why I say it's a spiritual experience, because it happened during the holy month. Ramadan. And that was the first time it happened. That was the first time I got that reaction. And what was deep, when he was speaking to me in Pula, I understood what he was saying.
Mm.
And I had never heard the language before. And but I understood. And you find this to be true of people, let's say, if they're of Spanish descent. And you know, their grandparents, it might be Spanish, and they grew up speaking English, but when they hear the language, they understand
it,
you know, but they can't speak it. And when he was talking to me, my brain was like, talk back. It's like, you're supposed to know this language. It was like an instinctive thing. Mm. But I wasn't able to speak. I had no words, but I understood what he was saying. And that's what touched me. So that was the first thing.
Mm.
And I didn't pursue it right away. I was just happy to be identified with any African people, and I just left it at that.
Yeah.
Later on, my granduncle, Alfred Holliday, who we did the DNA on, he came to New York City, and he did a slideshow presentation, PowerPoint, of all of our family and their different features. And I noticed we had very, you know, unique features that were very unique to my family.
Mm.
I still didn't put the two together.
Mm.
It was only until later on that year